Classification lets us pick one or the other, or some small number of labels for our data. The problem is that real life doesn't fit into these neat little categories. When we have labeled data that isn't yes or no, or A, B, or C, or some labels, right, then we have what we call a regression problem. We're actually trying to predict actual outputs. Right? So given these inputs, what's the temperature at which something will occur? Or given this movie on a streaming site and the attributes and the people that have watched it, what amount of action is it, right? Because that informs who should watch that movie. There's lots of times when you don't want to say this is this and isn't this. You want to say it's a little bit of this and a little bit of this, right? And that's what regression is for. So some of the algorithms we use for regression are actually quite similar to the classifier. So for example, you can regress using a support vector machine or a support vector regressor, right? But we also use other ones. So we're more likely to use things like linear regression and things like this. So let's start off with perhaps the simplest form of regression. That's linear regression, right? It might not occur to people who use linear regression, but actually what you're doing is machine learning, but you are. Let's imagine we have just data that's got one input, so one attribute, attribute one, and our output, which is y. And this is our table of data, just like before. And this is our instance data. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, like this. So what we want to do is we want to input attribute 1, and then we want to output y, which instead of being a yes or no, is going to be some number on a scale, let's say between 0 and 1. So really what we're trying to do is we've got our graph here of our input variable, attribute 1, and we've got our y output, and these are our data points in our training set. So here, like this, and they sort of go up like this. What we're going to do using linear regression is fit a line through this data, right? And a line is of the form y equals mx plus e. So in this case, m is going to be the gradient of our line and c is going to be the intercept. So in this case, I guess something along the lines of this, straight up like this. So if our m was 1, in this case, m equals 1, or maybe it equals 1.2 to make it slightly more interesting. And then our c is going to be, let's say c is 0.02. These are the values that we're going to learn using linear regression. So how do we train something like this? Well, what we're going to do is we want to find the values for our unknowns, which are m and c, given a lot of x and y pairs, right? So we've got our x and y pairs here, and we want to predict these values, right? The optimal values for this data set. So we're going to find values for m and c where this distance, the prediction error, is minimized. The better fit this line is, the average prediction error is going to go down. If this line is over here, it's going to be a huge error. And so the hope is that if we predict this correctly, and we have an M and we have a C, then when we come up with a new value that we're trying to predict, we can pass it through this formula, we can multiply it by 1.2 and then add 0.02, and that will produce our prediction for Y, and hopefully that will be quite close to what it is. So for example, let's imagine we have a new value for attribute 1, it's come in here, we're going to look up here, and this is going to be the prediction for our Y. Right, and that's the output of our regressor. So this linear regression is capable of producing predictions based on this attribute. Now, if we have more than one attribute, this is called multivariate linear regression, and the principle is exactly the same. It's just we're going to have lots of these multiplier m's. We could say something like y is m1 x1 plus m2 x2, and so on for all of our different attributes. So it's going to be a linear combination, a bit like PCA, a linear combination of these different attributes, right? And this is obviously going to be multidimensional. So one interesting thing about linear regression is that what it's going to do is predict us a straight line, regardless of how many dimensions we've got. Now, sometimes if we want to use this for a classification purpose, we still can, right? Now, I'm supposed to be talking about regression, not classification, but just briefly, if you'll indulge me, we can pass this function through something called a logistic function or a sigmoid curve, and we can squash it into something that's this shape. And now what we're doing is we're pushing our values up to 1 and down to 0. Right, and that is our classification between 1 and 0. So it is possible to perform linear regression using this additional logistic function to perform classification. And this is called logistic regression. Right? I just thought I'd mention that that's something you will see being done on some data. So let's talk a little bit about something more powerful. That's artificial neural networks. Right? Now, any time in the media at the moment when you see the term AI, what they're actually talking about is machine learning, and what they're talking about is some large neural network. Now let's keep it a little bit smaller. Let's imagine what we want to do is take our input attributes and map them to some prediction, some regressed value. Right? How are we going to do this? Well, what we can do is we can essentially combine a lot of different linear regressions through some nonlinear functions into a really powerful regression algorithm. Right? So let's imagine that we have some data which has got three inputs. So we've got our instances, and we've got our attributes A, B, and C. Our inputs are A, B, and C, and then we have some hidden neurons, right? And I'll explain a neuron in a moment. Then we have an output value that we'd like to regress. This is where we're trying to predict the value. So, you know, how much disease does something have? How hot is it? These kind of things, depending on our attributes. This is where we put in A, this is where we put in B, and this is where we put in C. And then we perform a weighted sum of all of these things for each of these neurons. So, for example, this neuron is going to have three inputs from these three here. And this is going to have weight 1, this is going to be weight 2, this is going to be weight 3. And we're going to do a weighted sum, just like in linear regression. So we're going to do weight 1 times A, plus weight 2 times B, plus weight 3 times C. Add them together, and then we're going to add any bias that we want to. So this is going to be plus some bias. And that's going to give us a value for this neuron, which let's call it hidden 1, right? Because this is, generally speaking, we don't look at these values. It's not too important. We're going to do a different sum for this one. So I'm going to draw them in different colours so we don't get confused. So this has got three weights. So this is going to be a different weight. This is going to have another different weight. And we're going to do this much times A plus this much times B plus this much times C. Add them all up, add a plus a bias, and we're going to get hidden 2. Right? And we're going to do the same thing with these ones here like this. This is going to be hidden 3, hidden 4, hidden 5, and so on for as far as we'd like to go. All right. Now, the nice thing about this is that each of these can calculate a different weighted sum. Now, the problem is that if we just did this, then what happens is we actually get a series of linear regressions, right? Because this is just multivariate linear regression. And in the end, our algorithm doesn't end up any good, right? If you combine multiple linear functions together, you just get one different linear function. So we pass all of these hidden values through a non-linear function, like a sigmoid or a tan. So a sigmoid goes between 0 and 1. So this is 0 and 1, and a tan, hyperbolic tangent, will go between minus 1 and 1, things like this. And what that will do is add a sufficiently complex function that when we combine them all together, we can actually get quite a powerful algorithm. The way this works is we put in A, B, and C, we calculate all the weighted sums through these functions into our hidden units, and then we calculate another series of weighted sums that add together to be our final output. And this will be our final output prediction Y. Now, the way we train this is we're going to put in lots and lots of test data where we have the values for A, B, C, and we know what the output should have been. We go through the network, and then we say, well, actually, we were a little bit off. So can we change all of these weights so that next time we're a little bit closer to the correct answer? And let's keep doing this over and over again in a process called gradient descent, and slowly settle upon some weights where, for the most part, when we put in our A, B, and C, we get what we want out the other side. Right. Now, it's unlikely to be perfect, but just like with the other machine learning algorithms we've talked about, we're going to be trying to make our prediction on our testing set as good as possible. Right. So we put in a lot of training data, and hopefully when we take this network and apply it to some new data, it also performs well. Let's look at an example. We looked at credit checks in the previous video, and we were classifying whether or not someone should be given credit. Well, something that we often calculate is credit rating, which is a value from, let's say, 0 to 1 of how good your credit score is. So A could be how much money you have in your bank. B could be whether you have any loans. And C could be whether you own a car. And obviously there's going to be more of these because you can't make a decision on just those three things. So what we do is we get a number of people that we've already made decisions about, right? So we know that person A has a bank account balance of 5,000, 2,000 in loans, and he does own a car. And he has a credit rating of 75. Or 0.75, whatever your scale is. So we put this in, we adjust these weights so that this is the correct prediction. And then hopefully when another person comes along with a different set of variables, we'll predict the right thing for them. Right? So you can make this network as deep or as big as you want. Typically, multi-layer perceptrons or artificial neural networks like this won't be very deep. 1, 2, 3 hidden units deep, maybe. But what's been shown in the literature is that actually, if you have a sufficient number of hidden units, you can basically model any function like this, right? As long as you've got sufficient training data to create it. So we're going to use Weka again, because Weka has lots of regression algorithms built in, like artificial neural networks and linear regression. So let's open up a data set we're going to use this time. So the data set we've got is a data set on superconductivity, right? Now, obviously, my knowledge of physics is, shall we say, average. But a superconductor is something that when you get it to a critical temperature, it has no resistance, right? Which is very useful for electrical circuits. And so this is a data set about what are the properties of material and what is the critical temperature below which it will be a superconductor? Right. Now, I'm sure there's going to be some physicists in the comments that might point out some errors of what I just said, but we'll move on. So we're reading the file. This is quite a big data set, so we have a lot of input attributes, and then at the end we have this critical temperature that we're trying to predict. This temperature, if we look at this histogram, goes from 0 to 185. If we look at some of the other things, so for example, we've got this entropy atomic radius, which I can pretend I know what that is, which goes from 0 to 2.14. Is that good? Right, what we're going to do is we're going to start by using multivariate linear regression to try and predict this critical temperature as a combination of these input features. So I'm going to go to classify. There's just one classify tab even for regression. We're going to use our same percentage split as before, so 70%. And we're going to use a simple linear regression function for this. Let's click go. So we've trained our linear regression, and what we want to do now is work out whether it's worked or not on our testing set. So we've got the variables we wanted, y, and we've got the variables that have been predicted, y hat. And hopefully, they're exactly the same. If they're exactly the same, then they're going to be on a straight line like this. So we were hoping to get a y down here, and we did. Now, of course, this won't actually happen. What will happen is these y's are ever so slightly different than the y's we were expecting. So you might see a bit of noise around the center like this. And the way we would normally measure this is something called mean absolute error, or mean squared error, or root mean squared error, which are all very similar ways to measure the same thing. It's to measure what is the average distance between what we wanted and what we got. So if we were hoping to get a y of 0.2, but we actually got a y of 0.4, then our mistake was we were 0.2 too high. And so for every single instance in our test set, we can sum up all of the errors we've got, and we can work out what the average error was, right? So if we have 100 in our test set, we sum up the errors and we divide by 100, and that tells us our mean error was a certain amount. What will sometimes happen is your predictions will be above or below. Right? And so your actual mean error might be zero, because half the time you predicted too high, half the time you predicted too low, and so on average you got it exactly right. Obviously that's not correct. So what we tend to do is calculate something called mean absolute error. So essentially, if you're too small, we just remove the minus sign and call it an error of that amount. Right? So if your mean absolute error is 0.4, then what that's saying is that on average you're 0.4 away, either above or below, than where you were hoping to be. It's also quite common to see similar measures like root mean squared error. For every instance, we take our error, we square it, we sum them all up, and then right at the end, we take a square root. Right? And again, this is a very similar measure to mean absolute error. Right? The squaring removes our negative symbols for us. It's also quite common, particularly in fields like biology and medicine, to see something called R squared, or the R squared coefficient. And this is essentially the correlation squared. It's a measure of how well, or how tightly correlated, our predictions and our ground truth were. For example, this would be a pretty good correlation of maybe 0.8 or 0.9. If these were our points like this and were absolutely perfect, that would be an R squared of 1. If our points were everywhere, that would be an R squared of 0. And what that's saying is it's a value between 0 and 1 that tells us how well we predicted. 0 means you basically didn't predict anything at all. It was completely random output. 1 means you predicted everything exactly correct. Now, of course, that's unlikely to happen on a test set, but what you'll find is you'll hope to get some number that's somewhere around 0.7, 0.8, right? But it will depend on how difficult your problem is to solve. Right? So maybe on a really difficult problem, an R squared of 0.5 is actually pretty good. Right? So it's just going to depend on the situation. So we've got our linear regression trained up. We know that the correlation coefficient is 0.85. We know that the mean absolute error, for example, is 13 degrees. What we haven't done is visualize this. Sometimes the simplest way to do this is just to plot a scatter plot of what we wanted and what we actually got from our predictor. So I'm going to right click on linear regression. I'm going to say visualize the classifier errors. This is going to be a scatter plot of the expected value and the prediction we actually got from our networks. So you can see, generally speaking, it's not too bad. Obviously, the data set is quite bunched up in some of these areas, which means that it's sometimes harder to predict, but we've got a general upward trend, which is exactly what we wanted. You can see that the prediction around zero is not good at all. The x-axis, in this instance, is the actual critical temperature of that particular substance. The y-axis is what the linear regression actually predicted. You can see that the range here is from about zero to about 136 on our actual values, and the predicted values are from about minus 30, which doesn't really make sense, to 131, but they're pretty close, right? Most of the ones that have caused a problem are the very low values, right? Because you've essentially got lots and lots of values that have a very small critical temperature on this scale, but different attributes. That's been hard to fit a line to, right? Something more powerful, for example, a multi-layer perceptron, you know, an artificial neural network might do a better job of those kind of instances. But you can see that there's a general upward slope. In this particular scatter plot, the larger x's represent a larger error. So you can see this is the line we're actually trying to fit here, down here with all these small x's. And there's quite a few of them on there. So actually, for a lot of these substances, the prediction, even by linear regression, has been pretty good. Regression algorithms let us predict real scalar data out of our input variables. And this can be really useful in a huge array of different situations where we want to predict something that doesn't fit neatly into a yes or no answer or an ABC category label. We've looked at linear regression and artificial neural networks, and obviously neural networks get pretty deep these days, but these are a great starting point. So thanks very much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this series on data analysis, something a little bit different from Computerphile. I wanted to thank my colleague, Dr. Mercedes Torres-Torres, for helping me design the content. Please let us know what you liked, what you didn't like. Let us know in the comments what you'd like to see more of. And we'll see you back again next time.